Oh, so I watched Joker.
Perfect time.
Oh.
How do you say "oh" all the time?
But yeah,
You want
watched
to
Joker. And then I also watched about 10 minutes, maybe 15, of Zombieland 2,
Oh,
and then shut it off.
yeah. That's about right.
I was just seriously like not really laughing the whole time. Like it was not, I don't know.
They waited too long.
They waited way too long.
It was, yeah,
They should have struck while the
they were
iron was hot, man.
lucky yet unlucky enough to have it be right when all those careers took upturns.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I mean, that
All
was
got way
before
too
True
busy making
Detective,
another
yeah,
fucking. It
and
was
before like
before Woody
Emma
had
Stone.
his recent upturn.
Yep. Oh,
And
Emma
it was right
Stone,
on the
fucking
cusp of Emma Stone.
Abigail Breslin,
And Jesse Eisenberg had maybe
Eisenberg,
done, well,
Social Network.
had he done
I
Social
don't
Network at that
think
point?
that was
no. I
after.
think
I think
he
it
was.
was
I
right
think he
before
was.
that
Yeah, I think it
too.
was just before Social
So it
Network.
was like they couldn't.
I wasn't interested in that. I'm not gonna watch it.
Yeah, at
Double
all.
Tap? No.
And yeah, at a certain point, I was also just like, they got contrived real fast, and now I honestly just don't care about anything, so why am I watching this? Because, God, immediately it turns into just like Abigail Breslin is like, I'm not a little girl anymore. Look at me. Look at the way they dressed me in this movie. I have fucking boobs now. I want a man around. And Emma Stone and Jesse Eisenberg having relationship problems. The two girls run off, and then it's just the Woody and Jesse show for a little bit. And then they discover who I thought was, why am I blanking on her name? I've been blanking on her name since I saw her. She was Lindsay in Freaks and Geeks. She was the,
Linda Cardellini,
I thought it was Linda Cardellini. And they just put like
Velma
a,
Dinkley.
I thought they just dressed her up like a
Yes.
gullet. And I was like, it seems weird. Like there's an age difference between Jesse Eisenberg and Linda Cardellini, but it wasn't Linda Cardellini. It was this other fucking chick. But I was,
Yeah,
for a
Linda
second, I was
Cardellini
like,
definitely looks like she's in her 40s now.
Yeah.
I mean, she's
She was,
still quite attractive.
No,
Don't
yeah, I'm
get me
not saying
wrong.
she's unattractive. I'm just saying she
Yeah.
definitely looks like she's
But
older now.
that age disparity, I was like, this is weird.
Did you see this?
Oh, I think I do. I know what this is.
You got the touch.
I need to watch that again.
Yeah.
The only thing that's missing is I want to soar like,
Yeah.
yeah.
That's beautiful. Great edit. Yeah. You like Joker then? Both of you guys, do you like Joker?
Yeah, I liked it.
I really liked it.
It was very good, especially for like, I don't know, Warner Brothers comic book fair, but
Yeah, I mean it's a standalone thing. It doesn't need anything to help it bolster its like its world really. It's already pre-established like character that everybody knows,
what
and
I
it's just
like
a
and what some people find as a detractor is you could take all the Batman elements out of it and still have it be a movie.
Oh yeah,
You know what I
exactly.
mean?
Yeah.
Yep.
And I was
What I like is that you can anybody viewing it, you can pick parts of the story that you like and
Yeah.
actually incorporate that into your version of the Joker's
Right. Well,
backstory.
this might as well just be another version of his own origin story that he has in his head.
Exactly.
Like,
You can look at it
right.
like
There's no reason to say or
some parts of it
some
could be true, some parts could be not.
Yeah.
I mean, some parts you could say that, I mean, you could say that this Joker isn't the real Joker. You could say that
Oh
he
yeah,
inspired
he inspired
the
somebody
Joker.
down the
Yeah.
road, but I
I'm just like I don't know why most people didn't take it as this from the get-go, but I was listening to a podcast and they're talking about it and they're just like, you know, it'd be better off if you just consider it like an Elseworlds, which is like the DC
Even that,
the
I just look at
DC
it
like
as
alternate universe thing. It's hard sometimes for nerds to
detract from like the main
to
canon.
separate, yeah.
Exactly, but I see it as just like a tour de force of Joaquin Phoenix.
Yeah.
And
Oh, yeah.
a character study of somebody that has.
See, that's just it. It's not even necessarily like the story or the writing. I don't know. But it's how everything played out that I really liked. Like how it was
The
shot,
revelations
how it
and.
was, yeah, the pacing of it, the different things that come into play, how everybody, all the performances. Like
The
that's
everybody
what I
around
really
it
liked.
worked really well.
Yeah.
I didn't. The revelations didn't work for me.
Like which ones?
Well, pretty much just the one of him, of them having to, because I get it. For general audiences, I totally get it. Them having to show explicitly that she was not there for
Oh, yeah.
certain scenes. I
Okay.
was like, all right, this is for my
I was
taste, it's
irked
way too
right
on
when
the
they did
head.
like the slow-mo kiss. I was like, I'm not sure about
Well,
this. And then it turned out I was like, oh, okay, I predicted it right.
yeah.
Because I was
Well,
like, this
because
is
if you
just
notice
bizarre.
too, like on in the other scenes that she's in, more often than not, she's like behind him and kind of comes up. Like she's not like right there with him. It's like she kind of enters in
And
right
as
there.
far as I noticed,
That's what I picked
she
up.
never physically interacts with anything while he's imagining stuff. And
No.
that was the only other weak part for
Just stuff
me.
that we can understand. I went with my mom, so I was like, "How soon did you figure out that she was not there?" She's like, "Oh, I didn't know until they told me."
Oh
And
wow.
I was like, "Oh."
Yep.
I was like, "I pretty much right away." Like
Like exactly. But that
during
was
that first kiss.
the only part that was weak for me is I started to understand how the movie was displaying what was real and what wasn't real. They definitely wanted to have it be very open-ended, so most audiences would just be like, "Wow, yeah, this could have happened, this could have not happened."
Because
But
most of it is,
when she was behind him and not touching him, or when he was imagining stuff with Murray or anything else in his life that was imagined, in my opinion, in that movie, it just became way too clear of like, okay, well, this is in his imagination. Now this is actually happening around him, but this is how he's imagining, like
that's
how
just
he breaks it
it
down in his
becomes
head.
like it was is the stuff with what's her fuck the only thing that we've been shown that's not real.
No.
You
A
know what I
lot of
mean?
people
Like
think that at the very end when he actually gets hit with the ambulance,
yeah,
that was a
that's when
blackout
he,
moment. And then he imagines the part where they lift him out, like Christ-like, and he goes like I'm happy now.
it does
And
the
then
smile.
after that, he just wakes up in the
Sanitarium or asylum.
Arkham.
I think, I don't know. In my opinion, that
And then
part
kills
did
that lady.
actually happen.
I
That's
think
just my opinion.
the parts that did happen
It's
for
just
me
it.
were the violence. The violence happened because that incited the community to rally
Well, and
behind
to me
him.
too,
And then
once
the part where
when he's
like he
in the
shoots
makeup.
Murray, they cut out to news stories, actual news footage
Well,
of that action happening. So it's not in his head that he
to me,
did that.
whenever he wore the Joker makeup, that was real.
Yeah, every second of
Because
that was
he
real for him.
like when especially there's the big thing of stuff getting more real as it goes through because he's coming off of his drugs, right?
He's becoming more erratic, especially when he goes to the theater.
Once he finally like it puts together throughout and he starts there's less of the split between the crazy and the kind of meek whatever thing when it finally kind of lines up and which I see is when he puts the makeup on finally.
The white makeup,
Yeah,
he's just
like when
like on his
everything has
tongue.
like this is it's all come together now. He's completely off his meds. His delusions like or
The part
his
of that that
that
really
I
drove
fucking
that
love.
home was the idea that he had, and I think the directors really wanted this scene in there, is when he jumps in the refrigerator,
Yeah.
and that's like him going into his cocoon
Oh
and
yeah,
like
being
busting out.
reborn.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I thought.
Yeah,
So he comes out of
rebirthing.
that and he's like, all right, let's fucking,
Do it.
that's life.
Yep.
And he's dancing. He's like,
And then
let's get this done, guys.
that's one of the things I heard people were just like, or I had read an article or two where they're just like, I don't get why like after he kills that person, then he goes into that bathroom and starts dancing or whatever. I'm
I
like,
totally
I
connected
totally get
that.
that. That makes perfect sense.
I mean, that's
That's
the Joker. That's his.
he's everything like
That's him.
I was
him that's
talking
our
to.
his thoughts and his actions
No.
finally line up and it's a moment of like bliss for him.
Clear clarity. He.
Yeah.
What I think I relate to it to the character. I always thought of this because what he says at the beginning is like, nobody really sees me. He was talking to that social worker saying, "I'm becoming like more invisible. You're not really listening to me and all this stuff." And it's getting really crazy out there nowadays. And I don't know why I keep coming here because I think I'm invisible to everybody. When he kills people, he notices that, oh, people are starting to take notice of me. So he's becoming more visible to people, and he likes that power. So he's like, he doesn't really know how to react to it. So he's just like basking in, like, I'm actually alive now. I've taken lives and it felt good because they were awful people, like he says to Murray.
My feelings are finally like being expressed. Like I'm fine. Like I was saying, like all that stuff finally lines up. Like it's not what's in his head and what he wishes he could do versus what he actually does.
And did you notice that
It's cool.
his nervous tic goes away when he becomes the Joker too?
Yeah. Well,
He
and
like he
it's
does it mockingly when they like laugh at him for doing something weird, and he's like, I
well.
think that's like a spurt of him wanting to be more conformed, because that's
That's
at,
if you notice
in his
throughout
notebook
the.
he says, mental illness, you know, people expect you to act as if you don't have a mental illness, and that's what he does. So he like in those nervous situations he laughs uncontrollably, but when he becomes more to himself as the Joker, he's just like, he takes it in and he's just more
But it was
calm and like
something
looking at
that there
people.
was a conscious thing though too. If you notice, like when he does the kind of more jokery sounding laugh, not his nervous, like whatever laughter, he's to like it, to me, it seems that's when he's purposefully do it. Like when he's like getting all suited up for the clown stuff or whatever, and they tell him he's gotta go see somebody, whatever, and he walks out of the room and they make a joke and he laughs, and then he's doing that kind of jokery laugh, and then he rounds the corner and immediately
Shuts
drops
it
it.
off. Yep.
Or when he's at the comedy club. And everybody's laughing at where they're supposed to, and then he chimes in like a little after, and it's with that Joker laugh. It's his like his like front he's putting on of like understanding
His conformity.
people,
No,
kind
yeah,
of, yeah.
he's trying to conform to the perception. Like, there was parts where I think he wasn't really present at some of these comedy shows.
Yeah.
At the one that he went to, yeah, his girlfriend wasn't there or
Yeah,
whatever.
yeah,
She
yeah, yeah.
wasn't there, but his perception of the crowd's reaction was totally off base too. Like he did that one punchline, but then like the music and everything comes up and they drown
Well,
him
and then they
out
show you how it really happened on
on
the
Murray, and then he's just
Murray
like,
show.
oh, shit.
Did you
The
notice that's kind of a nerd deep cut kind of?
Art Deco Murray
Well,
font.
the font was the exact
Yep.
same as Batman the
Batman
animated
animated
series.
series. Murray Franklin
On
show.
his yeah,
It's
the Murray
the.
Franklin show, the way that's written is the exact same as the Batman the Animated Series
And did you
fonts.
notice
I
the
guess it is
Pogo?
image.
That's the name of
Yep.
John Wayne Gacy's
Yep.
clown name.
Yep. The only
And William
thing.
Street was named after Bill Finger
Yep.
on the street where she goes to the bank and whatever.
And I don't know if it's intentional or not, but the scene of him in the cop car is kind of reminiscent of the.
Joker. That
Well,
wasn't
it's an
really.
opposite type of
Todd
situation.
Phillips talked about that a little
Did
bit.
he?
He
Okay.
it was inadvertent, but he was like, he then realizes like, I love playing homages to all these other people.
Yeah.
Because there is stuff
There
with
was another. Oh, did you catch the homage to the 66 Batman series in there?
remind me again.
It's
I probably did.
really silly, but it's just when he shows up at the Wayne's house
Yeah.
and Bruce is playing,
And he goes down the
he goes
pole.
down the fireman's
Okay,
pole.
now that you mention it, I was like, oh, there he goes down the
And that
pole.
was definitely purposeful.
Yeah, oh God, yeah.
He said as much, I think, but.
The only other thing about the movie, like, it's still a really good movie.
Yeah.
The only other thing that I don't like about
Oh
this
no, dude,
movie, as
it's
far as
definitely
like
flawed as fuck,
Joker
but
goes,
for
is
me.
I wasn't scared of this Joker the
No.
other ways I've been scared of, like, the Joker I've read about and like
Well,
seen and stuff,
and part of that too
is
is
because you
no, yeah, this
understand the crazy
that's why
much because
my headcanon
you've
is that
seen
he's
how he
not the Joker. I see him as inciting
precursor.
precursor to the, because the age disparity between
Yeah.
Bruce and
Yeah.
him is like, all
Yeah.
right, he's gonna be like 80.
It's either that or some
But
kind of Elseworld
the
story for
general
me.
idea is
But
Bruce becomes Batman around 20 to 25.
and this guy's already
So
40.
another 10, 15 years at least, probably somewhere around there.
So he's gonna
But
be a
and I
50,
don't mind.
60-year-old
I kind of
Joker.
like Joker being a little older than Batman, but like that's a lot of older,
That's
you know what I
I
mean?
know, noticeably.
Yes.
But yeah, I think it's because I understand the crazy a lot more, showing how he was abused, how he's been on medication and seeking, like, getting mental monitoring, if not help.
Right.
Like, I
And
understand that crazy a
it
lot
wasn't about
more
being beat
than
down by
I
society, as
had
far as I
this.
think. It was
No.
people not. He thought he was invisible to the world.
Yeah.
It wasn't
It was
his
an in it
fault.
was an internal thing.
It was all, yeah, it was all medication and internal
Yep.
and lack of budgeting or funding for his issues
Yep.
and lack of
It
help.
was him being helpless, essentially.
Right. But I like that, but I also don't like how he wasn't as tactical and as chaotic as the real Joker.
Right.
Joker, like, well, he's a criminal mastermind. Like, too, he can plan shit that just goes off without a hitch.
You can see it too. But like he's just like how I see Man of Steel, where it's like he's not Superman yet. Like, he's not Joker yet. He just assumed that.
Yeah.
Like, as his brain becomes clearer, for lack of a better term, that may come. You know what I mean?
He ain't even got to the Red Hood part yet. Because, I mean, who knows? At some point, if this Joker, like, let's suppose they don't need to make this movie, but they did specifically show at the very fucking end Bruce standing over his parents in the alley. So I was like, okay, that actually happened. So now, somewhere down the line, he's going to become Batman. Then, if that happens, we are going to get that kind of clash. Good chance he's going into a vat and Ace Chemicals, and he might be altered.
That may become a permanent thing.
To have parts of his brain jiggered around and accentuate what's already there,
right?
And then the permanence of the mat, right? Like the makeup, and then the rictus kind of smile shit. Who knows?
No, yeah. All of the stuff
things I discussed.
You can cherry pick that stuff.
Yeah. When I was at work at Paradox the other day with one of my coworkers, we were talking about that. Just villains in general, how like the sign of a good villain is, you know, and that are a well-written villain for the most part.
Their motivations are relatable.
Are relatable and understandable. So you both see where they're coming from, but understand how terrible they are.
Right. They're going about it in the worst kind of way.
Right. But that's also at the same time, you could go two ways with it. So, and some more successful than others, you can do them both ways and they can work in both ways and they don't. But, like, you could go, like, specifically we were talking about Loki at the time.
Mm.
How, like, you know, in the comics up until he became huge in the movies, he was just a straight villain. Now he's kind of an anti-hero.
Right.
And that kind of happens once a villain becomes super popular. They kind of make him into an anti-hero.
He's just, so he's like the Joker.
They
doesn't follow any ideology.
They did it with, you know, Deadpool back in the day and, like, stuff like that. They made him anti-heroes.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, and to some things that work, to me, it doesn't really work with Loki. But then there's the other side of it where you don't give anything. And I think that's what makes Joker terrifying, is you have no idea, like, anything about the guy.
Even at the end, why he's that way. Know is that there's no mercy waiting for you.
He's literally a force of nature.
Yeah,
right.
That's what makes it terrifying, is because he shows up and you don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah.
You don't know what version of Joker you're going to get. Mm-hmm. Is he going to be the weird, happy fuck with you Joker? Or is he going to be like I'm insane, I'll murder everybody Joker? Like, there's so many facets to him via the different writers through time,
right,
that aren't any less relevant, because they can all be Joker, because there's nothing stating it's outside of his character.
No, yeah, right? it's all
chaos.
It's all
his order.
He's a force of nature.
He just is.
And so, like, seeing, yeah, so like, that's what makes, and then I can see then why it makes him less scary to do something like this, where it gives him a more,
I mean,
for lack of a better word, concrete origin. Than, like,
but still,
others.
It's open ended.
But it's still it's not as ambiguous as like the Heath Ledger one, where he's like giving you different scenarios, but that he's feeding you. But through your watching of this movie, there are a bunch of different scenarios that could occur, and ambiguous things that you don't know. Not because he's purposefully directing you that way, but it's because it's how it's presented and through his fractured psyche.
It's from the
so
point
it's still
of
ambiguous
where...
to a degree.
Oh. I mean, even the name Arthur Fleck he was adopted.
Yeah.
I mean,
yep.
You could look at it like, okay, that's not his real name.
So they say.
Yeah. I mean,
you never had a concrete evidence.
That's
that
he was following him the whole time, and you're like, okay, the revelation of, like, maybe Tom, it was his dad.
Yeah.
But then I could totally see it
you could see it, like, if you
Tom has the means to, like, pay for people to shush.
Right. It was a thing I knew going in about the possible Thomas Wayne fatherhood thing. And
you could still subscribe to that idea.
Yeah,
like, that's cool.
It still works, because everybody who is close to it, be it Alfred or Thomas Wayne himself, or, like, you know, the other people, like, it, the way they acted could be seen too as like, oh crap. Like,
yep.
This,
oh, you're.
Oh,
oh. Oh, you're
this
her,
has come back.
This
to,
has come back.
Yeah.
You're her boy. Okay.
But there's also a logical reason why they'd act that way too, because, as they said, she's crazy and started all this crap.
And she's been writing all these letters.
Yeah.
And, like,
so you don't know. it's possible. Like, I know they did a like a little interview or whatever with the guy who played Thomas Wayne.
Mm-hmm.
He was kind of operating under the mindset that he was his kid. Or that's how he read it.
Sure.
But
you can. You can cherry pick, like
it,
I said.
It does make it interesting having the Joker then be the
because they've done the Cain and Abel duality thing of Batman and Joker.
Yeah, it's always been they're each other's opposite.
Exactly. You know what I mean? So it makes sense.
And to have this be his neglected brother is interesting. Because in the comics too, there is a thing where I know you're waiting. there's a thing where they did have an older kid,
mm-hmm.
and he died.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, and that's. That's one thing that either never gets referenced or gets, or like, and or is something someone's like, hey, do you remember when this was a thing? It did get directly referenced in a, to the point where so it had a guy who claimed to be that brother in a recent Batman run. But you know, never for sure, you know what I mean? Like that type of stuff. But so that's not a disparate thing that isn't, you know, possible. It's definitely a thing that's existed in the books where not that Joker is his brother, but that he had a brother that died when he was young or before.
I think Joker throughout history has always seen Batman as his opposite and doesn't want to kill Batman.
No, he's obsessed with him. He loves him.
No, exactly. So in a way, there's still that brotherhood relationship.
There's many stories where Joker pretty much says that, like, pretty much says, like, we can't exist without each other.
Yeah.
Like, basically that he loves him because, like, you can't exist without me.
From
I
the
can't
Killing
exist
Joke,
without you.
From the Killing Joke all the way to, like, Dark Knight.
Yep.
And now, like, this, like, kind of is there a little bit. And then even in Phantasm.
Stuff, because there was the whole Batman Catwoman going to get married situation. And then it gets fucked up by Bane and his machinations going on. His attempt to ultimately break the bat. And there was a special where it was Joker and Catwoman, like in a church or whatever, and they basically like almost kill each other. But it's a lot of like discussions of stuff kind of like that, where it was just like you're, you know, I'm the only one that's good enough for him type of situation. Like, mm-hmm. you know what I mean?
You want to know what my favorite Joker theory is?
What?
Arthur Fleck.
Affleck.
Goes up. kills Bruce.
Yeah.
Kills Alfred.
Yeah.
Gets his own Alfred. Just hires Jeremy Irons and is like, be my Alfred.
And he is Batman.
And then he becomes Batman. And now Justice League. And then Zack Snyder. And my arm's getting tired.
But see, Jared Leto was a joke.
That's why he's damaged.
Yeah.
Because he learned from Arthur Fleck. And he's like, oh, you got to be just a mentally ill fuckboy to be the Joker.
That would have been more accepting.
You just got to email, Joker. Or you have to mail people condoms and dead rats.
Hey, that's not the Joker.
I would have been more accepting of Leto's Joker if the fan theory would have proved to be true, where they said, like, you know, you see the, you look at the Robin costume that's in the Batcave,
mm-hmm.
and like, and this was assuming, too, that this was Jason Todd's costume because he was the one who got killed by the Joker. But Zack Snyder was like, nah, it's Dick Grayson's costume. But regardless, you know, it's got the bullet holes in it, and then it's got the ha-ha-ha, whatever.
Yep, spray
and
paint.
Then there was a thing where they showed Joker, and he had his shirt off or whatever, and it looked like he had scars in, like, mm-hmm. the same spot. It's like, dude, if this was Jason Todd and he didn't die, but he came, or he did... didn't die.
Lazarus Pit.
Fractured and came back as this new version of the Joker. That would have made it, I would have forgiven most of the shit and would have been interested then in that dynamic then with Batman.
Yeah.
Because that would, but
there was still just not enough time to really, really expound Jared Leto's Joker anyway.
Well, in that movie, but they had, like...
There was nothing in that movie.
They had, like, over an hour's worth of, like, Joker shit that they did.
They did,
and only,
but...
Like, and only, like, 10 minutes of it ended up in
not
the movie.
Used, yeah.
Yeah. I do, like, the one thing I do, like, simply because I love the image that inspired it, was when they did the, the Alex Ross send up with
yep.
Joker in the tuxedo and Harley in her costume and they're dancing.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I liked that just simply for that.
Yeah. No, yeah, that's the imagery is great. It's the portrayal and like the behind story. The scenes shit that's just kind of off putting and maybe some of the choices.
Having the trailer team cut the movie.
And the trailers, I don't know how many trailers came out for that.
It was a couple.
There's four full trailers.
But it was the people, because
each one got more neon as you go through.
Because they have, I'd be interested to see David Ayer's version. There's a couple, that's funny that.
It won Oscars.
The history of, that's all I gotta say. The legacy of the like Snyderverse movies is that there are two very different versions of a movie sitting somewhere in Warner Brothers. I mean, Snyder didn't complete Justice League, but like
Chittick.
But there's, you know, a probably a roughish cut of the Snyder movie somewhere. And there's the David Ayer cut of Suicide Squad that exists. But there, we'll never see those, either of those.
Same with the solo movie with the two dudes.
Yeah, that must have been so like just taking the air out of you when you, for David Ayer, where he's no pun intended. I didn't intend that. Where he put all this time in the movie and had a specific vision for it and made it, and then because the trailer for his movie was so successful. The company was just like, and because of the reactions to the other, you know, people's reactions to the other DC movies, they're like, well, they like this and it's lighthearted and fun. Let's give these trailer people a shot. And then they tested those two and then they were just like, we're going to go with the trailer people's version. Like, how terrible would that feel?
Pretty bad. Cutting trailers is fun, but like the companies that do those, they really miss the mark with what the director wants to convey, mm-hmm. as far as like how to tell the story.
Mm-hmm. Look at the trailers for fucking Drive.
Yeah.
Made it look like a fucking Fast and the Furious movie.
Yep. I still want to see
it. That's why so many people, I went to it again once it was released. Because I saw it in San Diego. And I came back and it got released. And I was like, I got to go to this with people. Like, I got to bring people to this movie. So I went. And then you had a lot of people afterwards that were like not happy and like, because you could tell they were expecting what was advertised in the fucking trailers, which was a fucking driving movie when there's what, two scenes of him driving, maybe?
Yeah, the beginning and then
the chase.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's a cruising scene with him and what's her fuck, where they just drive around.
In the LA River, yeah.
Yeah, that's the real human being part. But
another movie that took inspiration from Taxi Driver.
Mm-hmm. I loved Nicholas Winding Refn.
Have you not seen Taxi Driver?
No. I want to watch that again soon. I've been thinking like, man, I want to watch Taxi Driver.
So I said when Joker was about to come out, I was like, we should watch Taxi Driver, King of Comedy, and Joker, and then talk about all three because those two movies are essential DNA for this movie.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like. Anyway,
give Joker a thumb up.
Yeah.
Hell yeah, fuck dude.
But I was gonna say Nicholas Winding Refn, when we saw it in San Diego, he was there and he was talking about it. He was like, to me, this is a superhero movie. Like,
oh yeah, no, it's a fairy tale.
Yeah, because he's like, you know, you have this dude and he wants to do the right thing or whatever, and then
he saves a princess.
He goes through a transformation and he puts on a mask. And he goes and takes out the bad guys. It's like, it's a superhero movie to me. And I was like, holy shit.
It is.
You're right.
It's an allegory. It's a fairy tale because he's like knight in shining armor. And he gets super violent. He's like Prince Charming if he was like hella violent.
In the most literal way too, because all those Prince Charmings you have, like, you don't know who the fuck they are. Like, is this their real, like, some you don't even know their name, like
the scene, like him, the like, scene when he actually, he like,
say anything
when he knows he's about to throw down with that guy in the elevator, and the girl's in there too. He does that really passionate kiss, and then it goes hyper real, and he's like, "Go bam!" And he's just stomping the head, And then he, like, at the very end, he's like, okay, Prince Charming has kind of teetered to, like, Psycho Charming.
Yeah.
And he's, like, he's just looking at her as the door's shut. It's like, all right, no more Prince Charming. He's like, I'm checked out. This is me now. I'm going to fucking save you.
Yeah.
Even if you don't like the way I do it and my methods. But, yeah, peace out.
I either got lucky or just somehow never saw a trailer for that movie, I don't think.
Dude, if I would have seen a trailer for that movie, I would have been so confused. I would have been happy, actually.
Oh, yeah, like, I would have been like...
Odds are, if I saw that trailer and hadn't read anything about it,
yeah, right,
I wouldn't have gone. It,
I think I saw Valhalla Rising, and I liked Nicholas.
Yeah.
And I was like, I'm going to go see this because I liked Valhalla
Rising. I hadn't seen Valhalla Rising before that. I had maybe seen... like, one or two articles, like, as I was... scrolling Ain't It Cool back in the day, and but never like read them. And then it wasn't until we were in San Diego and Matt was like, hey, I'm standing in line for a screening of Drive, you guys should come over because they're just handing out passes right in front of the theater, and I'm in line right now, like right up towards the front. And I was like, I have no idea what the fuck this is, but okay, like it's an early screening of a movie, so
yeah, why not.
I mean, it was the first showing in the US, I think, was there.
Hey guys, what do you call a dried grape that is the Norse god of thunder?
Say it again? I didn't hear anything.
What do you call the Norse god of thunder who's a dried grape?
The hell, raisin.
Oh, yeah. Raisin.
Like, what I saw, your amusement with Valhalla Rising. And then you said sour grape. No, like, or dried grape. I was like, I know.
Alright. You guys ready to do a poke?
Yep.
I'm gonna do
a smoke. This is just gonna be a grindy one.
Okay.
Because we're not ready to take home this gym yet. We need